Rob, my PA, says that I can listen like a vacuum cleaner. Always beware of somebody who's a really good listener. I've heard it said that some people feel that they are being avoided once the news gets around that they have Alzheimer's. For me, it's been just the reverse. People want to talk to me on city streets, theatre queues, on aeroplanes over the Atlantic, even on country walks. They want to tell me about their mother, their husband, their grandmother. Sometimes it's clear to me that they're extremely frightened and increasingly. Regular tasks to sit in the coroner's court where I learned all the manifold ways the disturbed human brain can devise to die. High bridges and trains were, I suspect, the most traumatic instruments for all concerned, especially those who had to deal with the aftermath. Newspapers were a little more kindly in those days, and we tended not to go into too much detail. But I had to listen
it's
to it.
Discrimination, I think.
Now remember that coroners never used the word insanity. They preferred
the
more compassionate verdict that the subject
Why
had taken his
And there were powerful opinions for and against among Conservative MPs.
I understand the Catholic and faithful people in principle what you should say this. But I am slightly afraid that they should seek to sustain a legislation that limits my
That's why I dislike the term assisted suicide, applied to the carefully thought out and weighed up process of having one's life ended by gentle medical means. The people who thus far have made the harrowing trip to Dignitas in Switzerland to die seem to me to be very firm and methodical of purpose, with a clear prima facie case for wanting their death to be on their own terms. In short, their mind may well be in better balance than the world around them. I'll return again to my father's request to me that I was unable to fulfill. In the course of the past year or so, I've talked amiably about the issues of assisted dying to people of all sorts because they have broached the subject. A lot of them get nervy about the term assisted death and seriously nervy about assisted suicide. But when I mention my father's mantra about not wishing to go on living supported by the pipes and tubes, they brighten up and say, oh yes, I don't have any problems with that. That was the problem reduced from a sterile title into the wishes of a real person in whom perhaps they could see themselves. When I began to draft this speech, the so-called debate on assisted dying was like a snowball fight in the dark. Now it seems to be occupying so much space in the media that I wonder whether something is in the air, an idea whose time is really coming. Very recently, an impassioned outburst by Martin Amis in an interview he gave to the Sunday Times, called for euthanasia booths on every street corner. I firmly believe it was there to trap the heart of irony, and I note that it has done so. He was, after all, a novelist talking about a new book. Did it get publicity? It surely did. Apart from being tasteless, the idea is impractical, especially if there happens to be a photo booth next door. But his anger and grief at the way elderly relatives, friends and colleagues have died is clearly genuine and shared by a great many. The post-war generation has seen what happened to their elders and are determined that it shouldn't happen to them. Even more recently, the British Social Attitudes Survey found that 71% of religious people and 92% of non-religious people were in favour of medically assisted dying for patients with incurable illnesses if they should so request it. Insofar as there are sides in this debate, they tend to polarise around the Dignity in Dying organisation, who favour assisted death in special circumstances, while others support the Care Not Killing Alliance, whose position in a nutshell appears to be that care will cope. And once again, I remember my father. He didn't want to die a curious kind of living death. He wasn't that kind of person. He wanted to say goodbye to me. And knowing him, he would probably have finished with a joke of some kind. And if the nurses had put the relevant syringe in the cannula, I would have pressed it and felt it was my duty. There would have been tears, of course there would. Tears would be appropriate and unsuppressible. But of course this did not happen, because myself, my father and the nurses were locked in the aspic of the law. But he actually had a good death in the arms of morphia, and I envy him. I got involved in the debate surrounding assisted death by accident, after taking a long and, yes, informed look at my future as someone with Alzheimer's, and subsequently writing an article about my conclusions. As a result of my coming out about the disease, I now have contacts in medical research industries all over the world, and I have no reason to believe that a cure is imminent. I do think, on their good advice, that there may be some very interesting developments in the next couple of years, and I'm not the only one to hope for some kind of stepping stone, a treatment that will keep me going long enough for a better treatment to be developed. I said earlier the PCA at the endgame is effectively the same as Alzheimer's, and that it's the most feared disease among the elderly. And although I was diagnosed when I was 59, it has struck adults in their 30s. I enjoy my life and wish to continue it for as long as I'm still myself, knowing who I am and recognizing my nearest and dearest. But I know enough about the endgame to be fearful of it, despite the fact that as a wealthy man I could probably shield myself from the worst. But even the wealthy, whatever they may do, have their appointment in Samara. For younger members of the audience, I should say that the fable Appointment in Samara is probably one of the oldest stories in the world and has been recast many times. And its central point is that you can run and you can hide, but every man has his inevitable appointment with death. It's worth a Google. Back in my early reporting days, I was told something that surprised me at the time. Nobody has to do what the doctor tells them. I learned this when Chief Reporter George Topley slung my copy back at me and said, "Never say that a patient has been released from hospital unless you're talking about someone who is being detained on mental grounds. The proper word is discharged." And even though the staff would like you to believe that you just can't walk out until they say so, you damn well can. Although, generally speaking, it's best not to be dragging a portable life support system down the steps with you. George was a remarkable journalist who, as a fiery young man, would have fought fascism in the Spanish Civil War were it not for the fact that he stowed away on the wrong boat and ended up in Hull. And I remember what George said and vowed that rather than let Alzheimer's take me, I would take it. I would live my life as ever to the full and die before the disease mounted its last attack in my own home, in a chair on the lawn, with a brandy in my hand to wash down whatever modern version of the Brompton cocktail, a potent mixture of painkillers and brandy some helpful medic could supply. And with Thomas Tallis on my iPod, I would shake hands with death.